Junior Slice and then Big Bird.
Hello, hi, how are you? And welcome to another podcast by George. Did you hear that? Well, that what you've been listening to there is instantly recognizable to part of my audience. They'll know exactly what that is from the first sounds. The rest of you'll wonder, what the hell is that? Well, folks, that's Beaker Street. That's a big part of anybody's life that was a rock and roll fan, a radio listener back in the late 60s and early 70s, all throughout the central United States, up into Canada, down into Mexico. It was heard in Cuba. If you could get an atmospheric bounce, it was heard all around the world because it was on KAY down in Little Rock. Of course, I was on a 50,000-watt clear channel radio station. A lot of the listeners know that on WHO. So I've got an affinity for these 50,000-watt clear channel radio stations. And that was one, and that was Beaker Street. And at night, you could hear it just about anywhere if the conditions were right. And that was a big deal back in the day. It wasn't like the internet today. I mean, the fact that you could be in Des Moines, Iowa, and hear a broadcast out of Little Rock, Arkansas, particularly with rock and roll radio. That was a huge deal. Well, anyway, that gets us to our guest today. I want to introduce him, bring him on in here. This guy's name is Richard Robinson. He's keeping Beaker Street alive, basically, on the World Wide Web as an administrator for a Facebook page that has Beaker Street on it. And Richard, I want to welcome you to a podcast by George and have you explain a little bit your unique personal connection to Beaker Street.
Well, thank you. Bye, George. It's great to be with you. And I'm really enjoying, going to enjoy our time today. I first got acquainted with KAY when I was 10 years old growing up in Conway and listened to KAY all through high school and college. And of course, Beaker Street started when I was in junior high school. So I'm kind of an old guy. And then I moved around in Arkansas. I was in radio for a number of years and wound up going back to get a master's degree at the University of Arkansas at Little Rock in 1992. And during that time, I needed a research project for one of my classes. And my father-in-law is Eddie Graham, was a former studio engineer at KTHS, the forerunner at KAY, and was at KAY for nearly 30 years, told me about a situation where the KAY and several other 50,000-watt stations broadcast Spanish propaganda to Cuba during the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962, which is a whole nother program. And I wound up doing research on that and interviewing Pat Waltz, longtime general manager of KAY. And then, of course, when I got into a doctoral program at Southern Illinois, I needed something for a dissertation, and I pitched several items, ideas, and titles, and my committee didn't like any of them until I got to Beaker Street. And what intrigued them was the fact that, first of all, they didn't really know about it much and didn't really know about the program, didn't understand it. And the other thing was nobody apparently had ever really written about it before other than in magazine or newspaper articles. So that was kind of how it all came around. Beaker Street is more what historians would call recent history, 50 years plus. But still, my pitch to my PhD committee was, if I don't interview some of these people now, in 10 or 15 years, a lot of them may be gone, including me. So they bought it, and I wound up doing it. And I owe a lot to Dale Seidensports, Clive Clifford, the host, who gave me a lot of interviews and a lot of help in finding out things about Beaker Street that otherwise I wouldn't have known.
Yeah, and you mentioned his name there, Clyde Clifford. He was the voice that you heard on KAAY. And Beaker Street from about 1996 to 72 in there when they were on the AM radio. And to kind of give you a little visual, a mental picture of this, imagine me now. I'm a kid in junior high and then in high school. And, I could park my car on a high spot and look down on the high school football game that was underway from a distance. I didn't really care to be in the stands. I wasn't a rah-rah kind of a guy, but I could listen to Beaker Street and I could watch that high school football game kind of solitary out there by myself, maybe pop open a beer or two. That was my experience with Beaker Street. And God, we're old radio guys, Richard and I, so I can tell all kinds of stories. I mentioned, Richard, at the beginning about the sounds of Beaker Street. Now, that's interesting. People, it was unique. It was a programming decision, but there was also a real reason for it. Clyde Clifford wasn't broadcasting from the downtown station of KAAY. He was out at the transmitter. Well, transmitters make noise. So you got to muffle, you got to cover that noise with something. So that had something to do with that sound that you hear in the background all the time when he's talking. And Richard, I got to tell you this. So I worked at a 50,000 watt radio station. I worked at a 500 watt day timer. That was my first gig in radio. Okay, so talking about transmitters, that transmitter at that small station was in the building. It was in the basement here in Iowa, and well, in Arkansas too, but particularly in Iowa. I mean, we've got basements. Every building's got a basement. That one did. That's where the transmitter was. And when it would rain, a deluge, that basement would flood. The transmitter was down there. There could be as much as, you know, maybe 6 inches of water on the floor downstairs with that transmitter. And I used to sign the station on in the morning because it was a day timer. It went off at night. And I, you know, at 5 o'clock in the morning or something like that, I had to get that transmitter on. So the guy that owned the station told me to be very careful and very seriously. Now, what you do is you walk down the stairs down into the basement. They're wooden. And right there by the stairs is a wooden handled push broom. Grab that push broom, and from the third step to the bottom, you can reach the switch for the transmitter with that wooden broom. Trip that, and the transmitter will come on.
Oh, gosh.
Honest to God, that's a dead solid fact, boy. That's how I turned on the transmitter at the first radio station that I worked at. And you know, I just have such fond memories of Beaker Street, because if you were kind of a rebel or wanted to consider yourself one, which I did certainly, regular radio was all pop radio. It was all the same stuff in a cycle over and over again, and it was really meant for an older audience. If you wanted to listen to, you know, what we might call indie rock today, but if you wanted to listen to cutting edge rock, but really everything from the Rolling Stones to blood rock or something like that, it was KAAY. That was what their programming was. And they had an album-oriented format feel. Richard, can you kind of describe for the listeners what that is?
Well, yeah, in its day, in 1966, essentially, KAY was a top 40 station for the most part, although it was a split format, so they had a lot of different kinds of programming, sports, Arkansas Razorbacks, for example, and a lot of religious programming, Oliver Green, the Gospel Hour, The World Tomorrow, Garner, Ted Armstrong. But what they did was they were trying to figure out something to do with that time slot, that late night, early morning time slot. And the story goes that at a Mexican restaurant in Little Rock, a bunch of the staff were together one night, including the general manager, and basically they all got knee-walking drunk. And one of the program directors said, hey, we need to go with these album cuts because we can't play them, and the record labels are wanting airplay. So they kind of talked him into doing Beaker Street, which I think started out originally as 30 minutes, and then expanded it over time. And you're right, the noise of a 50,000 watt transmitter, back in those days, a 50,000 watt transmitter, clear channel, they had to have a first class FCC licensed engineer at the transmitter through the nighttime hours. It was required. Well, fortunately, Clyde Clifford was a geek. He had a first class FCC license, and he was out there anyway, playing tapes through the night. So they just went down there and put together a turntable and cart machines and whatever else he needed, and a microphone, and made his booth down there. So he actually wasn't, you're right, he was not going from broadcasting from the station. It was about 20 miles or so outside of Little Rock in a place called Wrightsville, which at that time, the only thing other than crop fields were the boys' reform school for the state of Arkansas. So there wasn't much out there. And but the problem was, as you know, whenever he would talk and then stop, the cooling fan noise would rush in and destroy basically what he was trying to say. So they came up with this idea, we'll mask it by just playing a continuous loop of some sort of sound effects. And the first thing they used was the dream sequence from the movie Charade by Henry Mancini. They later moved into something else called Cannabis Sativa by Head. And it was this eerie space-like kind of effects, you know, woo, and all this sort of thing. And So what happened was that that worked very well for them. Well, the problem is, I mean, the good thing for them was this was about the time that the hippies were really going and a lot of drug use and things like that. So it just sort of fit in with the times. And most people thought that Clyde Clifford was this drugged out guy who just, you know, got on there. He didn't sound like a normal DJ. He wasn't high energy. He was kind of low key and like, you know, I'm Clyde Clifford and, you know, that sort of thing. And Clyde got that reputation, but in reality, Clyde was a geek. He's a brilliant guy, an engineer. And in fact, when he, they started the program in 66, Clyde left in 72 and went to KLAZ, which was is B98.5 now, I believe. And they actually ran the program until 1977 with several hosts. My friend Bob Steele, who was in radio and television for years in Arkansas, still is, hosted it some. Tom Rusk, another engineer, hosted it some. And then in 77, after it had been bought out, they eventually did away with the program. So
wow, that's
came
great.
Back 10 years later, but that was another story.
And, you know, you talk about the difference in the formats of the programming. When I started in radio, we were doing Top 40. I was a disc jockey, and it was all George A. your DJ coming at you loud and proud with all the picks that click right here on the music go-round. You know, let's go and check out the Willie the Wino out at the Weather Shack with today's forecast. I mean, I can do all that crap still. That's what we used to do. I mean, it was how fast you could talk. And so I want to play a little bit more of this recording of Beaker Street that I'm going to peel off of YouTube here for you to listen to Clyde Clifford. Listen to his delivery. Listen to that background sound that Richard's talking about. This won't take very long, and we'll come right back.
Here's the camera. Oh, it cropped it. And Layla.
So that may have had a lot to do with just the kind of guy that Clyde was, kind of a laid-back voice on the radio. But I want to tell you, in the central part of the United States particularly, that was really unheard of to do that kind of announcing. Then you had that sound in the background, which was never used. There'd never been anything like that on radio that I know of. And then the music that he was playing was something that you couldn't hear anywhere else. So if you tuned this in, you thought, wow, I'm really in on something. This is kind of weird, kind of cool, but it's very unique, and it's something that I can kind of claim as my own because not everybody's up late at night listening to that. So, I mean, I think that was the attraction of it. And Richard, there's a unique heartland connection to this. Iowa. I've even seen in the Wikipedia pages for Fire Sign Theater that there was a connection with Iowa listeners, Des Moines, Iowa, and particularly a band out of the University of Northern Iowa that Beaker Street championed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. And in fact, my father-in-law tells me that KAY was the number one rated radio station in Des Moines, Iowa for many years. And I know I wrote my dissertation for my PhD on Beaker Street, and I've got a copy of a news article, which I think it was a high school in Des Moines, Iowa, where the students voted two stations as their favorites. One of them was an Iowa station. The other one was KAAY, in particular, Beaker Street. The reach of that program was phenomenal because, as you know, during the daytime, 50,000-watt clear channel station, KAAY covered essentially the state of Arkansas with the exception of the extreme corners, pretty much. But at night, when they went directional, and you had Skywave kicking in, they reached from Canada all the way down into South America and even further than that. I've got a letter from a confirmation of the Royal Woodbridge Air Force Base in England, where I think some students from the University of Arkansas had picked it up there in England. There were reports that soldiers over in South Vietnam during the Vietnam conflict had picked it up, but I could never get any confirmation of that. But I know that Pat Walsh told me that they would receive postcards from people who were on cruise ships going through the Panama Canal who picked up the station and listened to it at that time.
Wow, that's what I described earlier, is that atmospheric bounce. That's probably not a very good technical explanation, but that's what you're talking about.
Right, that's exactly right, where the radio wave goes up into the ionosphere and comes down at a point, I think, not less than 600, 700 miles away. It's pretty unbelievable that a station like that could have heard it. You know, you had mentioned earlier underground rock and that kind of music. This was not so far out of bounds on the extreme East Coast, like New York, where you had, Allison Steele, or the West Coast, Tom Donahue, who is sort of credited many times with creating the underground rock format. But I think something that's overlooked a lot of times is that this station in Little Rock, Arkansas, developed quite a following and was sort of ahead of its time in a lot of ways, and is still remembered by a lot of people today. As you mentioned, there's a Facebook page, there's a blog site run by a gentleman named Bud Stacy in Mobile, Alabama, who has no connection to the station other than he was just an ardent listener. And in fact, Clyde Clifford is working on trying to come back and start Beaker Street again in some capacity, whether that's radio, podcasting, I'm not sure. So still a lot of interest out there, still a lot of people who remember it. And he would get, when they went on a line, let's see, he went off in 72. He came back in 87 once a week on Sunday nights at an FM station in Little Rock, and they were streaming. He would get letters from Switzerland and Sweden and Europe and all over the place. Reach has been phenomenal.
There are radio clubs, as I recall, and I know that again from WHO, even the smaller stations that I worked at, where people sit around at night and try to pick up stations, and what they'll do is they'll log exactly what they've heard, and then they'll mail that, or they used to be back in the day, probably digitally now, but ask the station to confirm that that is exactly what was said or heard at that date and time, so that they can prove that they were listening to you. And that can be done, again, if the conditions are right. It happened at that 500-watt radio station that I was working at. I mean, if you're on at night, it's possible that they can hear you just about anywhere. And again, that seems, I'm amazed by that, but God, the days that we're living in now, that it's just kind of laughable almost, I guess. Well, and for our people that aren't radio aficionados, that don't know a lot about this, 50,000-watt clear channel at night, local stations had to sign off, like the daytimer that I was at. They had to open that up, and then that's what allowed this frequency, this signal to carry so far, and it was the maximum allowable by the FCC here in Iowa. Now, just over the border in places like, Guadalajara or something like that, they could put up stations that had 100,000-watt transmitters. And that's where, if you're familiar with the ZZ Top song, I heard it on the X and stuff like that, those stations were out there as well. But in the United States, KAAY in the central U.S., it was as big and as powerful as any station going, and the music was just absolutely great. And I love to hear you talk about Clyde, Richard. I know you know Clyde. And most of the people are just going to know him from those broadcasts. What kind of guy is he? Is he a hippie kind of a guy?
Well, if you looked, I took a picture of him. I got a picture of him when he was about 18, reading the news in the studios in downtown Little Rock. And he had long hair, which was pretty common for that time. I used to have longer hair too. And then I took a picture of him in 2007 when I did a sit-down extensive interview with him. And he still got the beard and all. Beard's is white. Looks a little more mature now, like a lot of the rest of us. But, he was sort of looked like the hippie, but he was really not. When he left radio and left KLAZ in the mid-70s, he went to work for the University of Arkansas Medical School. University of Arkansas Medical Sciences, as a television video engineer, and just recently retired from that position. So he spent well over 30 years doing that. Unfortunately, Clyde has become ill, so that sort of put on the shelf the idea of bringing back Beaker Street for the time being. But And I hope I'm not talking out of school, but it's been pretty well common over the internet that he has been diagnosed with multiple myeloma, which is a type of blood cancer, but is extremely treatable right now. And this client's in his 70s, but he's been going through some treatment. It's been going very well, and he hopes to get back on where he can get Beaker Street going again.
Oh, God, good on him. Clyde, best to you. I mean, take care, pal, particularly with this coronavirus thing going around. Stay sequestered. I mean,
yes.
Stay under quarantine and get better. That because I would love to hear Beaker Street and just to hear that voice again in whatever format it might take. Well, I knew we'd run into this. I knew get a couple old blabbermouth radio guys on a podcast like this. We'd run out of time, Richard. But you get the last word, as all my guests do. What would you like to leave us with as far as waxing nostalgic about Beaker Street?
Well, it was an incredible time to be in radio, as you may know. It was an incredible time to be in radio, in Little Rock, which was an extremely competitive market. KAY dominated the broadcast scene in Arkansas for many, many years. In fact, one time when they got their Arbitron ratings in, they shared the ratings with the sales staff, and they said, don't tell the advertisers what our ratings are because we don't think anybody's going to believe that we're that strong. They were innovative in their programming. They were innovative in their promotions. Pat Walsh was a genius and later became a radio and media consultant. Unfortunately, he's no longer with us. And a lot of others are no longer with us as well. So it's one of those things that it's a program that was there and we'll probably never see anything exactly like it again. But it's what's amazing to me is that it not only was historic in a lot of ways, it still is vibrant today, and that there's so many people, and I guess it will stay that way until a lot of us are dead and gone. There's so many people who remember it and love it and listen to it and support it and follow it. It's just an unbelievable phenomenon, really.
That's great. Makes me think of my 65 Chevy Impala Super Sport convertible with the stereo on, sitting out there on a high spot listening to Clyde Clifford and KAAY and Beaker Street. Richard, I really enjoyed this. We could bring you back in again just to talk about radio, but maybe Beaker Street, whatever the case might be. I hope folks here have enjoyed it as well. We need a little bit of a break. And that's going to wrap it up. We're going to do it for today. If you like this podcast, please subscribe to the YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, share us on Twitter and iTunes, all those places where podcasts and video casts, I don't know exactly what you want to call them, are heard and seen. But for right now, folks, that's another podcast. By George.